would join with me this morning as we enter our call to worship. Our Father, we may have had a hard week at home with school or work or even in our communities, and we have come this day looking for refuge. All week long, we have longed to be in your presence. When we come forward, sometimes you seem not to be there. When we reach backward, you could not be found. We look to the left, but we could not see your face, and we even grope to the right, but because of the darkness all around us, we could not see you. In our time of worship together with you, O Lord, we seek the power of your presence today. Come, thou fount of every blessing.
Thank you.
And there are times when we need to just be still and know that God is with us. Be still and know. Let's sing together. And as we come to prayer today, we do remember our special prayer requests. Almighty God, you are holy and enthroned upon our praises. In every time and every place you have heard our cries, we have placed our trust in you, and we have never been disappointed. We rejoice in your holy name and sing praises to your glory. You meet our needs and provide for us out of your abundance. You give us far more than we ask or deserve by promising us the riches of eternal life. Yet, we can be easily led astray. We become attached to the things of this earth and put our trust in them. And then we are disappointed when they do not satisfy. For putting temporal things above heavenly things, forgive us, O Lord. The things of heaven are put into our grasp, for we have a high priest who leads us to the throne of grace. Send us out in the power of your Holy Spirit to proclaim that same grace to all the world so that all may know you and sing your praise. Many people suffer and they know why. Others are straining under burdens which they don't understand, and the load seems heavier. Lord, give rest for troubled minds. Give release to hurting bodies. Give hope to those in despair. Be their comforter. Grant us all salvation. Knowing that all things are possible with you, we ask all these things in Jesus' name. Amen. Let's pray the Lord's Prayer in unison. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. God will take care of you. Let's sing together.
So Donna is leading us through a series with Job, which means it's hard to have services where we have a big smile on our face. kind of setting the tone to look at Job this morning. And we don't often get a chance to talk about her sermon, or do I discuss my sermons with her beforehand. We like to be able to receive them fresh on Sunday morning, but this week I did get to a little bit of a preview and got a chance to edit the bulletin and look at it. And it's very easy to get kind of down and out with all of what's going on in Job, but there's an important point that is in the passages today. And that psalm reading of Christ then quotes that beginning of that psalm on the cross. And we do have those times when we feel like everything is just dark and gloom. And those times can carry on for quite a while for some of us. In fact, it's learning to walk in those times. I don't know, maybe it's those feet in the sand type. Hebrews chapter 4 has some words for us this day. Let us hear these words. Indeed, the word of God is living and active, sharper than any two-edged sword, piercing until it divides soul from spirit, joints from marrow. It is able to judge the thoughts and intentions of the heart. And before him no creature is hidden, but all are naked and laid bare to the eyes of the one to whom we must render an account. Since then, we have a great high priest who has passed through the heavens, Jesus, the Son of God. Let us hold fast to our confession. For we do not have a high priest who is unable to sympathize with our weakness, but we have one who in every respect has been tested as we are, yet without sin. Let us therefore approach the throne of grace with boldness, so that we may receive mercy and find grace to help in the time of need. I don't know if you ever felt like you needed somebody that has walked the path before, that could walk with you in this path. That's what that passage is talking about. Christ has walked this journey. Why not walk it with him? Rejected, despised. And so I'm going to thank Donna for picking my favorite song, my favorite hymn. I remember coming back from deputation, and we would come into our home church, and the one who would organize the music, he remembered that this was my favorite song. So when we'd come back from home assignment, come back on furlough, this would be part of the worship service. I don't think I remember singing it in any of the other languages while we were in Africa. I know whom I have believed. Join with us as we sing. Thank you.
Well, when we left Job last week, he was huddled on his heap of ashes. He was the very picture of misery. His crops, his animals, his servants, his children, all had been taken from him as the Satan, the member of God's heavenly court, thought to demonstrate that given enough provocation, Job would turn from God. But Job hasn't done that. As we watched, he mutters words which no doubt some of us have repeated. The Lord gives and the Lord takes away. Shall we accept the good and not the bad from the Lord? Blessed be the name of the Lord. Phrases which have caused people for centuries to refer to the patience or the endurance of Job. Is it enough to talk about God in times of trouble, to offer the teachings of faith in the face of catastrophe? Today we'll hear one answer to that question, and as you might have imagined, it's a resounding no. Job's endurance is at an end. Job is finished with these platitudes. Job is finished pretending that what's happened to him is in any way acceptable or even tolerable. The pious, willing to bear all without argument, Job, well, he's gone. Two things have happened to Job in between last week's reading and this week's. First, he has these friends. Job's friends. Have you ever heard that phrase? Have you encountered any of them? Well, at first, Job's friends are reduced to silence by the enormity and gravity of his plight. So much loss. They step away, and they wait in silence. They're accompanying him in that manner, which is so often the best of all, just a quiet sharing of grief. A stunned stillness of wonder that so much can go wrong. But then they begin to get restless, these friends of Job. They, like most of us during the time, believe that life should be just. Life should be fair. So in our presumptive ideal world, bad things do not happen to good people. Remember, we discussed that already. So they begin to accuse Job. You must have done something wrong. You must have made some terrible mistake. You must have engaged in evils about which we do not know. The only possible explanation for the calamities that have befallen him, they're his fault. The righteous are not cut off, they tell him. The wicked are punished. Job must have deserved what has happened to him. Well, we know those feelings and ideas, don't we? Every one of us. Have you ever wondered when something terrible has happened in your own life, whether God is punishing you for something? We want life to be fair. Well, let's go ahead and read the text. And actually, I'm adding more to the beginning and more to the end, so we have a little bit more of a context. Job's friends here are talking. Remember, Job's friends are actually talking nonsense. Submit to God and be at peace. In this way, good will come to you. Receive instruction from his mouth and lay up his words in your heart. If you return to the Almighty, you will be restored. If you remove unrighteousness from your tents, if you treat gold like dust and gold of Ophir like the stones of the torrent bed, and if the Almighty is your gold and your precious silver, then you will delight yourself in the Almighty and lift up your face to God. You will pray to him and he will hear you, and you will pay your vows. You will decide on a matter and it will be established for you, and light will shine on your ways. When others are humiliated, you say it is pride, for he saves the humble. He will deliver even those who are guilty. They will escape because of the cleanness of your hands. And then Job answered, Today also my complaint is bitter. My hand is heavy despite my groaning. Oh, that I knew where I might find him, that I might come even to his dwelling. I would lay my case before him and fill my mouth with arguments. I would learn what he would answer me and understand what he would say to me. Would he contend with me in the greatness of his power? No, but he would give heed to me. There an upright person could reason with him, and I should be acquitted forever by my judge. If I go forward, he is not there, or backward, I cannot perceive him. On the left, he hides, and I cannot behold him. I turn to the right, but I cannot see him. But he knows the way that I take. When he has tested me, I shall come out like gold. My foot has held fast to his steps. I have kept his way and have not turned aside. I have not departed from the commandment of his lips. I have treasured in my bosom the words of his mouth. But he stands alone, and who can dissuade him? What he desires, that he does. For he will complete what he appoints for me. And many such things are in his mind. Therefore, I am terrified at his presence. When I consider, I am in dread of him. God has made my heart faint. The Almighty has terrified me. If only I could vanish in darkness, and thick darkness would cover my face. We want life to be fair. We want God to be just. And we want to understand when things appear otherwise. Job 2 wants life to be fair and God to be just. And he knows that fairness and justice, well, at least not as we humans understand them, are not words that can be applied to what has happened to him. Remember, it was made very clear to us at the very beginning of the book that Job was a completely righteous man. A man who deserved none of what was about to happen to him. And when his friends can no longer contain themselves, and they begin to insist that somehow he must be at fault, he finally roars. His grief over his losses, his fury at his friends, and most of all, his bewilderment of God's apparent abandonment of him. He tells his friends that he has done no wrong. He is righteous in God's eyes. When they tell him to repent and then God will be his gold, he replies that instead, in his righteousness, he is God's gold. And that's the second thing that has happened between the readings of our two Sundays. Job has begun to speak of his anguish and his frustration with honesty. Job has begun even to speak to God. His so-called friends, well, he describes those as miserable comforters with windy words. But God? God he wants to hear from. And where is God? God seems to be silent, the silence of God. But Job wants to know where God is. And in crying out for an answer, he echoes the long biblical tradition of lament. Sometimes we think, or perhaps we've been told, that it's somehow wrong, incorrect, inappropriate to express our deepest angers and fears and sadness to God. I really don't know where we get those ideas, but we do. They get passed on. We think we're only allowed to express gratitude to God, or that we are only allowed to ask God nicely. That we are somehow rejecting God if we give voice to our hurts and our sorrows. But the Bible is filled with expressions of human unhappiness. The Bible is filled with voices crying out to God, "Why? How? Where are you? What were you thinking?" Many of these voices can be heard in the Psalms, and most particularly in the specific Psalms of Lament. Remember the Old Testament book called Lamentations? Other laments are heard in the voices of the prophets and in the words of Christ himself. As he dies on the cross, he cries in agony, my God, why have you forsaken me? Those beginning words of Psalm 22 this morning. His words echo the lament of human beings for centuries before him. Where are you, God? Why have you abandoned me? And those words continue to be heard today. When Job said in our reading, if I go forward, he is not there. Or backward, I cannot perceive him. On the left, he hides, and I cannot behold him. I turn to the right, but I cannot see him. When he deplores the resounding echo of God's silence, those of us who have been there turn to him in gratitude for his expression of the wails in our innermost hearts. But surely the greatest power in these laments is in the fact that they address God. Job, like those who gave words to the Psalms of Lament, like the prophets who contend with God, he goes directly to God. These voices do not circumvent God. They do not take a detour to avoid a direct confrontation with God. Even in the silence, they insist upon God. They insist upon speaking to God. They insist that God is present somewhere. We may not just feel him. And they insist upon God's faithfulness. Do you know that one of the most beautiful reflections on God's presence in the entire Bible is found right here in the midst of Job's agonizing sense of abandonment? Job has says, I know my Redeemer lives, and that at the last he will stand upon the earth. And after my skin has been thus destroyed, then in my flesh I shall see God, whom I shall see on my side, and my eyes shall behold him and not another. Those words came from a broken, hurt, bewildered Job who had lost almost all and is set upon by comfortless comforters. But Job is still insistent upon God's faithfulness. So insistent, in fact, that in today's reading, Job calls for a trial. Did you hear that? Well, listen. Oh, that I knew where I might find him, that I might come even to his dwelling. I would lay my case before him and fill my mouth with arguments. I would learn what he would answer me and understand what he would say to me. Would he contend with me in the greatness of his power? No, but he would give heed to me. There an upright person could reason with him, and I should be acquitted forever by my judge. Job cannot find or see or hear God, but he remains undeterred. What is the great grace, the great gift of God reflected in Job's words? That he longs for God, that his hope is God, that his belief in God's care for him persists. They're still there. Job is certain that the silence of God is not the last thing that he will hear. Silence of God. It's very silent indeed. And it's difficult for us to interpret. Have you heard of the grand revelation of Mother Teresa? That saint of the church who wrote about not hearing from God for most of her life and ministry? These words that Job utters is real. This desire to converse with God, to plead his case and how unjustly he has been treated after a life of unfaithfulness. After a life of faithfulness. It is an all too human experience that we find ourselves in the void, unable to hear or experience God's presence. And we know that we, like Job, experience that vast silence in which God resides that silence, which seems to reside in times of trial, that we too long to know that God is there. We long to know that God witnesses our suffering and hears our protestations that we are called to utter. And if we have the integrity of Job, we say so. If we have a remnant of hope, even in the face of destruction of all we love, we say so. Job did not have a choice about his losses, but he did have a choice about his response. This growing, maturing Job, the Job whose relationship with God calls him to integrity and honest self-expression, that Job responds fiercely. He leaves his friends way behind, and he heads directly for God, the God whom he believes wants to hear from him, just as he wants to hear from God. Somehow, Job knows, there is no rejection of God in lamenting our deepest woes to God. The rejection comes when we walk away or refuse to speak our truth, to bring our anger, our hurt, our bewilderment, our misery to God. That is to honor the living God, to approach the God with whom we claim relationship, not merely in the midst of plenty, but in the desert of nothingness. That is fierce faithfulness. Regardless of how we feel, let's proclaim our faith and our lives in God's service. Proclaim that God called me, and I will continue to follow him. At this time, let's get ready to sing, "Take My Life and Let It Be Consecrated, Lord, to You." He is there for us, whether we hear him or not. Take my life.